I'm your man.
Creepy is asleep in his MG, parked by camera one on the forecourt of the building when I get home. Is he guarding his parking space? Or hoping to trap the person who left the bum imprint on his bonnet? He suspects me of tampering with his precious old car. Nothing has been said out loud, but he makes accusations with his bloodshot eyes, sizing up my bum with bulging interest. He's plotting a move, getting ready to pounce, and I've used all my CS gas on a big fly. Passing through the garden, I take a look in Creepy's window at the familiar anal pink upholstery. No sign of anyone inside. He's snoozing in the car park, and Mrs. Creepy must be at work. Her husband died, then Creepy moved in with unseemly haste, UFO told me. There's no truth in the rumour that I'm giving the handyman hand jobs behind the bins, she insisted, with strict and detailed instructions to repeat this information to no one. Though it is not necessary for me to repeat it, because she has told everyone already. Why is she called UFO anyway, James asked, before going off to save the world. She saw one land in the garden last time there was a full moon. And it's a good name for her. When I'm exasperated, I can shout, UFO! Why be polite to someone nosy and vulgar just because they're decrepit? Well, appearances are important, and we're all respectable people here. There are no rats, Presbyterians, or anyone who shops at Harrods living in the building, UFO told me soon after we moved in. The synagogue next door now has a guard at its entrance, hoping to head off the Arab trap. I can see his flashlight flickering in and out of view between the bushes as I close the midnight blue velvet bedroom curtains. James phones to say goodnight. I run to the phone thinking it's you, almost knocking over the photograph on the dressing table. What would happen if I smashed it? Would that be a signal, a sign, a bad omen? Or a relief, something to cleanse the young me who's now the old me, leaving me to resurrect and start again? You're out of breath, James says, suspicious when I pick up the phone. He asks me to look for his watch. Maybe it's in his bathroom. No. Aren't you wearing it? I left it behind, he laughs, to keep an eye on you. It's a proper spy watch with a camera and microphone concealed inside. It's not here. Have another look, he says. Call me back if you find it. What's he up to? James never loses anything. Is there something in his bathroom he wants me to find? Evidence of fidelity, maybe, hidden under the bottle of perfume from Babylon? Is it even cold perfume when it's worn by a man? I'm always losing things. Nothing's ever where it's supposed to be, including my thoughts. What am I looking for now? Nothing. I've found you. Somebody to drive the getaway car. I've always disliked people who want to find themselves. It's much better to lose yourself and steal someone else's soul. Or borrow it and give it back later once you've sucked out the interesting bits. I'm bored, nervous, excited. A feeling something is about to happen. A tension in the moonlight. 2 days left until my show opens. 2 days until James comes home. I unbolt the door, stand in the garden for a few minutes, breathing in. The scent of jasmine and honeysuckle makes me imagine I'm not in England. Someone has stubbed out a cigarette in my palm tree. I remove it, check for lipstick stains, then throw it at Creepy Neighbour's door. I go back in, switch on the television, press play. I may as well watch the creepy show one last time. The repetition of him plodding past the cameras may send me to sleep. Creepy creates a shadow in my window on his way to the bins. It's midnight. I'm sitting on the floor in candlelight, sipping Nuit Saint-Georges, daring it to spill on the white carpet. The creepy show is playing silently, my television reflected into the garden, making two of him as he appears in real time. 9:11, Creepy passes camera too, carrying dry cleaning. He walks like a woman. 1442. Creepy comes umbrella first through the gate, pointing it at me like a musket. 1602. Creepy is talking to UFO outside her bedroom window. She inquires about his wife and Creepy replies, she's on an extended holiday with her mother. UFO reported this dialogue to Elvis, and for once the lip sync matches her memory of the conversation. She hasn't sent me a postcard either, UFO said. Does she usually send you postcards? Oh yes, I save the stamps for my cat. That may be true and it may not be. Her cat's a queer cunt who could have a stamp album in its full mink basket. Creepy doesn't return from the bins. At least I don't see his shadow crossing my window. There's something wrong, I'm not sure what. I rewind and watch again while we talk on the phone. I saw you coming towards me at the airport, you say, on one of those moving runways. You were going somewhere, I was going home, you didn't see me. As my runway passed yours, I almost called out your name, but you looked like someone else. I'm about to say you have it wrong, it must really have been someone else, because I haven't been to the airport this week. When I realise you're describing a scene from a movie. Let's run away straight after your show, you say suddenly. You make it sound like a joke, in case I don't like the idea. Yes, I agree immediately. Instead of acting out the ritual until the end, we just leave it out in the rain to drown while we live happily ever after. We're not like other people after all. Let's go now, tonight, I say, surprising you. But you can't go tonight. You have to finish shooting a commercial or no one will ever insure you again. It's just 2 days, you say. We can leave straight after your party. No, we'll go before that. As soon as you finish shooting on Thursday, it's best to leave before he gets home, I say, immediately regretting the use of that word. There's no escape from home. The husband must die before we disappear into the end. Otherwise, he will follow. He will always bring me home, force me to come back to him, make me sorry, punish me for loving him again and again and again. Unless, what if, like Elvis, I'm dead already? No one can see him hiding behind the net curtain at Graceland's except the other Elvis. What if I become invisible to everyone except myself? You'll never get a glimpse of God until you stop looking. It's kind of cool missing your opening night party, you say, like Garbo. Being mysterious could make my work more valuable. That and dying. You have to get up early, but I keep you talking. I want to listen to your voice until one of us falls asleep. Listening to you breathe makes me feel safe. Double indemnity, you say. Is that the new password? Yes. But you're wrong. Insurance is immoral. The policies are rigged so that only the company benefits. The real password, the one more important than love or even escape, is freedom. My freedom was contaminated when I tried to take out an emotional insurance policy to protect me from love. Instinctively I know this, but it doesn't harden into consciousness until it's too late. I have to go to sleep now, you say. No, don't go. We'll be together forever soon. Forever? That word gives me the creeps. Hanging in the distance between us like a warning I'll never see you again. Every time you leave me for a minute, it feels like goodbye. But you don't hear me. You're asleep already. That's James's line anyway. After hanging up, I check to make sure the front door is bolted and go to bed, Lights out, darkness. The scent of jasmine from the garden. Lights on, look under the bed, nobody home. That word again, following me, mocking. Is home the place of birth, the place of happiness, or where you live? A place of safety, a place of suffocation, a cocoon, a tomb. When talking on the telephone, you can tell if the other person isn't listening, even when there's no background fidget soundtrack. Falling asleep, I know you're dreaming about me, even though there's no evidence. I can smell your cigarette burning down in the dark, the one you almost finished smoking. I believe that you love me. I've missed the deadline for dying young, but it's never too late to escape.